Okay. So it's really good to see the crowds starting to come back after the pandemic. So thank you all for coming. So I'm Dave Waits and...
I'm Pia Sorensen.
And together we are responsible for sort of the history of something and this lecture series. And we thought maybe we'd start by saying a little bit about the history of how this all came about, this lecture series. So if I can figure out how to work this. Yeah. So maybe 13 years ago, 14 years ago.
The 15 years ago.
We invited Farhan Adria to Harvard. He came with Jose Andres, and so probably know both of them. This was even before Pia was here. It was a real shock to me to see like a rock star come and give a lecture in a physics hall. So that doesn't happen. We don't have rock stars. And we realized that we really should do something to... take advantage of that. And so we started a class, and Pia has been involved in that ever since. It's a science and cooking class. It's for Harvard students. And again, this is a physics class, and people lined up to take it. Lined up. Can you imagine that at Harvard, people lining up to take a physics course? We actually had to lottery it the first year. There's so many students who wanted to take it. We could start a whole bunch of new traditions. We have a recipe of the week, so people do a lab. The motto of the course is that you eat your lab. We have an equation of the week. And, of course, you have to clap for the equation. Does everybody get that? You have to clap for the equations? That's good. But then we also wanted, I don't know why this goes ahead, we wanted to share the chefs that we bring each week. So we have a public lecture, and that's what this is, the night before on Monday night. Here's some examples of the early classes. Joanne Chang, a flour bakery, she comes every week. Brian Furman, a pit master. And here's, I can't remember who is taking the picture.
So it's Carlos Tejedor.
Carlos Tejedor.
He's the guy with the phone.
Right.
And so, he has just made a foam up here, and we have displayed it on the screen. And he's stepping back into the audience to take a photo of his foam. And then you see that there's a person behind him taking a photo of him taking a photo. But then, if you look really carefully there, the person right there, you can see my face. I'm taking a photo of the guy taking a photo of the guy taking a photo.
So it was a picture and a picture and a picture and a picture. But it was amazing because the chefs had never seen what they actually created. We have many pictures of that where we just look at the microscope what they make and they take pictures of it. And that's what we do. That's what we're trying to do. We went on and had a course online, and Pia, maybe you want to say something about that?
No, this is just for those of you who are really into this kind of stuff and you're looking for other opportunities to do science and cooking stuff, these are some of the things we do. We meet here every Monday night. We have an online version of the college course that is available online. You can take it for free, do experiments in the kitchen, things like that. We have another course which focuses entirely on my favorite subject, which is fermentations. So there's an entire course where we make sourdough and talk about wine and cheese. We have a book which, after this lecture, you can go up to this table. And we had a small issue with the charging, but you just talk to the person here from the coop and you can order a book. And then one of the things we've been doing for the last year is we've really kickstarted our efforts to work with K-12 teachers, together with Kate, who's here tonight. This is Kate Streinfeld. For this year, we've worked with a bit more than 100 teachers. Some of you are here. Thanks for coming. This brings us to today and to what's going to happen for the rest of the semester in this room every Monday night at 7. So basically, what we've done is we've collected what we think are the kind of key topics, key physics and chemistry and sometimes biology topics that summarizes how we can understand food. We think that if you understand those topics, you can try to understand almost any food out there. It doesn't matter the culture, it doesn't matter how fancy, it doesn't matter how you made it. It's just these topics are there. So these are the topics. And then we have one chef every week who is coming to talk about this topic, but entirely from their perspective. So today we have Harold Dave. A few weeks from now, we're going to be visited by Joanne Chang from Flower, our local rock star who loves Flower. Yeah, there you go. We will again be out behind this building cooking barbecue with Brian Furman, the pit master. Luciana Bianchi is coming all the way from Galapagos to talk about how she thinks about using local ingredients in Galapagos and creating really haute cuisine, really fancy food from it. Jason Du is also local from Wuzong Road, just sort of around the corner. It's an amazing tiki bar. Mauro Colagrico from France. Rich Shi is also local. He wrote Koji Alchemy, the book. He's a fermentation and koji specialist, real guru. He's joined by Jennifer Rothman from Yellow Farmhouse. And Betty Petrova is going to come and talk all about chocolate, the science of chocolate. And finally, Alex Atala from Brazil is talking about how he uses ingredients from the Amazon to just make entirely new dishes, new creations, new flavors. I think that was all of them. That'll be amazing. You should come back. Okay, so with that, that brings us to today.
Yeah. So I think I have to introduce these guys from a bit of a historical perspective. So when we started the class, there were no textbooks whatsoever. The only book that we could find was this book on food and cooking. And so, well, that seemed like a great book. We didn't know much about it. And then we had somebody who was one of the teaching fellows, and we said, we're going to use this. He says, I know that guy. He's my father. And so Harold came, and that was the best thing that ever happened to the class, in my view, because Harold is just the most knowledgeable and the kindest person. He's been part of the class ever since. He's one of my favorite people. He's so knowledgeable, and he's so helpful. And then he brought along Dave Arnold. And so this is a science class, and Dave is somebody, I'm not sure he's formally trained in science, but I always learn new science from him. And so they're always my favorite people to start the class off. And Harold, Dave, thank you so much for coming. And Harold, it's all yours. They're also authors. You should read their books.
So actually, Dave is starting, right?
Come on, it's only going to take a second because
okay.
This experiment takes the whole length of the class.
Okay.
I wanted to run it. So we're going to talk in a little bit about acids. I think what Harold and I are going to be talking about in general is what we've been working on to kind of rework the knowledge that we already have in our old books. And so one of the things I've always said is it's hard to measure acidity at home. And so I found a very simple way to do it. So I'm just going to do it for you live, and it can be done with this $9.99 scale off of Amazon and a quart container and a plastic spoon and some baking soda. So I'm just going to do it live so you can see me so that you know I'm not lying. And I do not know what the concentration of acid in this is, and we're going to see whether I get it right, okay, at the end of the class. So with that, you know, I'll explain what I do later. You can start doing. I just needed to tell them that, you know.
All right.
I didn't want to cheat.
Okay. So keep an eye on him. Let's see. Well, as Pia said, Dave and I are approaching major anniversaries for our two books. And that always leads one to think about, you know, are they still up to snuff? Do they still stand up given the knowledge that's accumulated in the meantime? So we've both been exploring various things, and I think Dave breaking new ground personally much more than I have. What I've been doing, because I have to kind of cover everything, is to catch up on what has been happening in the literature in various subjects. But there was one thing that that I was really curious about personally, and so I'll start with that after starting very, very briefly with a subject that we have, or I have talked about the last couple of times here, which is about the issue of whether it's okay to wash your chicken before you cook it. Was anyone from last year still here? People who, so the basic issue was the authorities, people supported by the government agencies, tried to convince people not to wash their chickens before they cook them because that could spread microbes over the kitchen and that could cross-contaminate other things and cause problems. Anyway, all kinds of problems with the whole idea. And it's been clear after, unfortunately, after that public relations program that in fact it was based on not very good science. Last year I talked about a couple of studies that looked at it very directly and made it clear that what was really important is washing your hands more than anything else. And this year, there's a new study out by that same group. This is just to, so this is what the USDA supported research program purported to show, but in fact, that's not really what happens. And there's a new study out at the end of last year, after I gave this talk last year, looking at what happens when you give consumers, you give them a little pep talk about being clean in the kitchen, then you let them loose with ground turkey and see what happens. And what they found was that in fact, the most contaminated surface in the kitchen after they did their cooking was the spice container lid. I think probably because you actually have to exert pressure in order to open it. Not the sink, not the knife, the cutting board kinda, but people know to wash cutting boards. They don't think about the fact that they might be transferring something to spice containers. It's not clear that that's actually significant, but it's just another piece of evidence that in fact, washing your chicken, washing your food is fine as long as you're being careful about everything else and watch those spice containers. Anyway, first subject is making hard-boiled eggs or hard-cooked eggs, which have preoccupied me for decades now because I am able, where I live, to go to several different farmers markets and I can always get really fresh eggs. And you would think that that would be a great thing, you know, to get something really fresh. You can do something really special with it, but it turns out that really fresh eggs are really hard to peel after you've hard cooked them. And that's bothered me for a long time, and I've spent a lot of hours trying to figure out a way around this problem, partly to solve the problem, but also partly to understand why it's a problem. It's just really, really interesting. The egg turns out to be an amazing creation. So, fresh egg is around pH 7. As it sits there, it respires. The biochemical systems in there waiting to support the embryo slowly work away, and it ends up exhaling CO2. That raises the pH of the albumin. And the theory has been in poultry science for decades now that it's that change in pH that's significant. That's what makes the membrane that surrounds the egg white easily detachable from the egg white after it's been cooked. That's the mystery. What keeps that membrane in place in really fresh eggs? So you look online, you can find thousands and thousands of pieces of advice about how to deal with and cleanly peel eggs. And I've tried not all of them, but most of them, and they're not any better than my luck cooking. But one of the theories is that you could raise the pH of the egg white artificially by letting the eggs soak for a while in a solution of baking soda. Well, baking soda is around the right pH for getting that change, but I've tried it for days and days and days, and you know, you want hard-cooked eggs the same day. It doesn't really make a difference. So a few years ago, I realized that if you simply take baking soda and heat it, you turn sodium bicarbonate into sodium carbonate, and that actually is more alkaline than baking soda. And it gets you above the range at which it's thought that you can easily peel the eggs. And so I embarked on a series of experiments to see whether this would work. And this wonderful magazine, Lucky Peach, I don't know if any of you know it, but it had a short and wonderful life. And I wrote a piece for them about these experiments. And the great thing about Lucky Peach, from my perspective, was that they had Tony Millionaire on staff as the artist. And so he did all these wonderful caricatures of everybody who wrote. Anyway, this was my transmission from Outre space, as they called it. And so basically, the issue is, and the you know, my interest in this is not just how to figure out how to make hard-cooked eggs easily peelable. It's just always an opportunity to revisit the fact that the egg is an amazing object. The way it's made, how the construction itself, and its behavior. So this is a very quick kind of summary of what's going on. You start with a yolk. It enters the tube. The various layers get put on sequentially, and then in the uterus is where the shell is put on. And this journey takes a day. This whole structure, the yolk pre-exists, but this whole structure comes together in a day. It's just astonishing. And you can see that there are lots and lots of layers. There are layers within the yolk. There are two different consistencies of protein in the albumin. And then around the albumin are a couple of membranes. And then you get the shell. And the shell is made of calcium carbonate. So this is a cross-section of the edge of the egg. And you've got on top a cuticle, which is a mixture of lipids and proteins and minerals, a complicated mess to deal with. And then calcium carbonate structures, so minerals, and then two membranes at the bottom of the shell that are actually in contact with the shell and then with the egg white itself. The pores, well, and here's a micrograph of the pore. The pore is the way that you can get stuff into the egg, basically. You're not going to get anything through any other parts of it. And so the pores and their behavior are of a special interest. So you take a really close look, and this is the wonderful thing about being able to revisit subjects like this, because you get you know, more and more information about the basic aspects involved. So the closer you look, the more you see. And the amazing thing is that it turns out that those pores, which people thought were the main main way to get stuff into the egg, they're actually, most of them, dead ends. You can't quite see it on the screen here, but there's a basement to this hole. And it turns out that the structure is actually more like this, where you have so-called pores, but stuff actually gets in through these irregularities in this calcium carbonate structure before anything can get to the outer membrane or the inner membrane. So the question is, how do you get stuff out here to influence what's going on here? You can even, these days, take a really close look at those membranes themselves, and it turns out that there's an outer membrane, there's a thinner inner membrane, and there's a really thin limiting membrane. This is a micrograph of the limiting membrane, and what they're staining for here is lysozyme, which is one of the major egg proteins, and its isoelectric point is 8.5 or something like that. So that probably has something to do with the interaction of the egg white itself with the membrane materials. So membrane, complicated structure, amazing structure that a chicken puts together in a day. So what I tried to do initially was just to add baked baking soda, pH high enough to have an effect, to eggs, and they just didn't get through to the membranes or to the interface between the membranes and the white. So I thought, well, then maybe what I can do is strip some of the shell away to make it easier for the baked baking soda to get in. And that turns out to be a lot of fun. So if you put a bunch of eggs and water and some citric acid, which you can buy as sour salt in crystalline form to make something really concentrated, and it's very good at stripping the outside off of eggs. So you can see that there are the remains of some cuticle here, but all gone there. You end up with a foam of the stuff because you're generating carbon dioxide as you're doing the stripping. And you know, there's aquafaba. Maybe something can be done with aqua ova. And this is what the egg looks like. It depends on when you stop the process, but this is, I think, the ideal stage where you can begin to see through the calcified material into the membranes, but you still have enough intact that that it is intact. You can handle it. So, and just to give you an idea of how much fun the stripping process can be, I'll speed it up a little bit. But the eggs are kind of self-basting. You know, and I think this would be actually a fun physics problem to figure out the connections between the generation of CO2 from the shell as the citric acid is eating away at the calcium carbonate, and the buoyancy of that side, and how long it takes for the egg to flip, and what frequency. I think that could be a lot of fun for someone else, not for me. And it's very effective, and in fact can be too effective. So this is a close-up of the end of an egg where the stripping was really uneven for whatever reason. And so you can see pretty much bare membrane there and there. And what that ends up meaning is that the effect of whatever you put the egg into is very uneven as well. And another example, even closer up. So the membrane in areas is exposed and cracks as well as patches. So bottom line, it didn't work very well, and it was a pain and messy. So So I left it behind at that stage. I wrote what I hoped was an entertaining article about it for Lucky Peach, and I left it behind. So a few years go by, and it begins to bother me again that I really don't understand what's going on or know how to deal with it. And so, I think it was either me, I don't remember who it was, who accidentally left a hard-boiled egg in the freezer. We were trying to cool things down really quickly, forgot one, and I found this one. And it looks as though the shell is separating really nicely from the white. So I thought, well, maybe some kind of, because the watery albumin is going to expand as it freezes, maybe that pressure will somehow mess with the interface between the membranes and the albumin and do something useful. So I began to look at that. And it turns out that interesting things do happen. Unfortunately, not that useful because there was still patchy sticking to the membrane so that it didn't peel cleanly. But you end up with this really interesting reticulated surface, and you can see the freezing kind of brings out the inner structure of the egg. You can see this layer of white very distinct from this one, and similar things kind of happening in the yolk and the chalazi, the cords that hold it in place, separately visible as well. So it was really fun, like the self-basting eggs, but didn't work. Then I had the idea that maybe a really quick freeze is what was needed. So that's what you get if you just leave the eggs in the freezer and the eggs slowly expand and break the shell. But what if you make a really cold solution, that is to say a saturated brine? You can get way down to 10 degrees, actually whatever the temperature of your freezer is, and then take the eggs, which are pre-chilled, drop them in that really cold brine, and they end up cracking very quickly in a few seconds. And that's also kind of fun. You drop them in and then wait, and you hear a snap, and you pull it out, and you end up seeing, for whatever reasons, again, interesting physics, these longitudinal cracks in the shells. And it's pretty reproducible, not entirely, not as regular as I would have hoped, but these are examples of how cleanly the shells would break along those fissures. The problem is that, you know, every, I don't know, fifth or tenth egg ended up not working so well. And sometimes you would actually get separation, not of the shell from the white, but the outer white from the inner white. Again, cool to see, but not what I was looking for. So onward, this year, I was playing around with cal, thanks to the work of this company that's trying to make nixtamalization, the transformation of corn into masa for making tortillas and things like that. They're just doing wonderful things, making that easier and more interesting for people to do at home and in restaurants. And so they were selling calcium hydroxide, which is an even stronger base than baking soda. But it's also easy to get a hold of and, you know, relatively non-annoying compared to something like lye. So I thought that would be worth playing around with. It's gives you very high pH in a saturated solution, and the solution saturates at a very low concentration, which means that these are really inexpensive experiments to do. You know, citric acid, you have to really use a lot to strip the shells off the eggs. With this, you just use a tiny little bit, And my hope was that that would be a strong enough base that maybe somehow we would get through the shells to have an effect in the membrane area. And it was certainly very good at stripping stuff off the egg surfaces. So if you just take an egg and immerse it in a concentrated solution of cal, you end up very quickly with an oil slick. It's stripping away and freeing up the egg from the cuticle lipids, and they're certainly involved in blocking the access of stuff into the inside of the egg. So I thought it was going to go well until I tried to make eggs using cal as a pretreatment. It turns out that if you dissolve cal, calcium hydroxide, in pure water, in distilled water, boiled water, it's a very clear solution. And as I say, the solubility is low, so you usually end up with undissolved stuff. But if you make it with tap water, regular water has dissolved CO2 in it, and the cal, the calcium in the cal reacts with the CO2 to give you calcium carbonate particles. One of the reasons that this mixture of cal and water is called lime milk or milk lime, because it ends up looking really milky. And the problem is, if you think about it, you put eggs into a solution of cal, even if it's boiled water, the eggs are exhaling CO2, and the CO2 is coming through the pores. So what's going to happen? You're going to end up forming these little particles of calcium carbonate in the pores, which is going to block the access of anything in. And in fact, when I cooked eggs in after they'd been soaking in cal for a while, what happened was they actually started to explode because the insides were expanding, the pores were blocked. You know how when you cook eggs, usually you see bubbles forming on the surface of the egg? The bubbles couldn't get out, and so the eggs blew up, and that was the result. So that was my great idea for 2023. I have gone ahead and played around with, in more detail than I have in the past, I've worked with lye, partly because people are using lye a lot more these days in, you know, soap making and things like that. So it's easier to get a hold of, and people kind of know to deal with it carefully and that kind of thing. And it after the eggs are partly stripped using citric acid just for half an hour or so, they peel pretty cleanly. But that's still a lot of trouble to make a hard-boiled egg. And yeah, and if it goes wrong, if there's a crack in the egg, this is what you end up with. So, not so nice. So that's a kind of ugly example of, I don't want to leave you, since I don't have the answer to this for you, I want to leave you with a couple of useful things to do with eggs. One is that you can use the same set of chemical aspects to make something really interesting like this. So this is something I followed. I found a paper, kind of adapted it, and so this is a quail egg. And if you let it soak in a mixture of lye and salt for 7 days and then simmer it, it peels very nicely. And you end up with something that's beautiful, although it's very sulfurous. So you have to like that kind of thing. This is a kind of refined version of pidan, you know, the century eggs made in China. And the refinement came from China. So they're interested in making different kinds of things as well. And then something else you can do with this general set of chemical principles is actually poach eggs by levitation, or they poach themselves. If you add some acid to your poaching water and then drop the egg in, by the time it falls to the bottom and begins to cook and coagulate, it's also generating bubbles of CO2 because of the reaction of bicarbonate that's in the eggs already, naturally, and the acid in the surrounding solution. So you end up with the eggs beginning to float back up after a certain period of time. You have to balance the cooking of the egg with the levitation of the egg, but it's actually pretty easy to do. And then you can just scoop them off the top. You don't have to worry about whether it's done. If it's come up back up to the top, it's done. So that's eggs. And let's see. Yeah, OK, so I'll go through this very, very quickly. Coffee, wonderful subject. And I wrote about it. Let's see. There we go. Wrote about it in On Food and Cooking, and tried to place the use of standard home brewing techniques in the larger picture that includes espresso and so on. Basically, what you're doing when you're making coffee is extracting materials from the coffee grounds, and the percent of coffee grounds that end up in the cup are what determine the flavor. And let's see. So for a long time, in fact, for decades, there has been this coffee brewing control chart, which basically locates, in the case of brewed coffee, not specialty coffees, the relationship between the amount that you extract from the grounds and what ends up in the cup. And below a certain level of dissolved solids in the liquid, the coffee seems weak. If you extract a lot, but it's still weak, then it's weak and bitter. And then too much, and it's strong. Although if you don't extract much, then it's strong but underdeveloped. The ideal is a balance in the middle. And that's been the gospel in professional coffee circles for a long time. So this last 5 or 6 years, a group at UC Davis has been, at the request of the Specialty Coffee Association, revisiting this control chart. And they've come up with things that look very different from that. That original chart. These are the people involved. Jean Xavier does the sensory stuff. Bill Rustenpart is the chemical engineer, and Mackenzie Batali was the graduate student who actually did all the work. And basically, what they've come up with is, and this was published just a few months ago, a very different looking chart. So instead of these evaluative terms, they're using descriptors. And the descriptors are, if you compare weak and bitter with tea-like, well, I'm kind of interested in tea-like, not so interested in weak and bitter. So they've come up with essentially a remapping of the possibilities of extraction versus what's in the cup. And along these axes is the ratio of water to coffee. And so there are, at the bottom, sweet, thin, and tea-like. The classic standard is in the middle, sour and citrus, and thick and roast, bitter and roasted. And the thought was that, well, maybe classic standard means that people in general like a kind of blend of all these different possibilities. Turns out that's not the case. So when they did consumer testing, the previous one, what they did was ask many, many people to taste in these different sectors and then describe what they're tasting. So these are the terms that were that came up from the consumer groups. When you actually ask people what do they like, what you end up with is not something in the middle, that is to say, not this, but there were people who really liked brews in that area and that area, and people who really liked brews in this area. And in fact, this is kind of a no man's land. No one picked much in there. People were interested in these other areas. So they've come up with a map that looks like this, and with further more descriptive descriptors to give you an idea of what the possibilities are in these different regions of the extraction versus dissolved solids chart. So I wanted to explore this newly revealed, what would you call it, experiential space when it comes to coffee. So I really did nothing more than brewed a lot of coffee with a scale and with a refractometer to measure the dissolved solids. You have to make some corrections, but you can do it pretty well. And it's a lot of fun. And so the stars are the particular brews that I ended up trying. The one of them ended up in the classic standard, and that's why I gave it that color, but others were kind of all over. And what I found was that, in fact, I was interested in all of them. It's not that any of them tasted bad to me. They were clearly different, and it was really fun to get those different kinds of qualities out of exactly the same grind of coffee. Now, one problem is that you can kind of see that they're all kind of on this side of the chart. I wasn't able to get out to higher extractions, and so for that, you just have to grind finer. And when you do that, then you're able to move elsewhere in the chart. So it's something I recommend to anyone who's interested in coffee, is to do this kind of thing, to use this as sort of a map of areas and flavors that you may not have experienced before. Give them a try and see what you think. And it seems to me that in addition to that kind of opening up of a new frontier, there's also the methodology they use to work some of this stuff out is suggestive of other things that we can do with coffee that we're not really doing much of. So these are 30-second samples of the same cup. If you pour the water in, wait 30 seconds, add some more water, put it in the next cup, add some more water, put it in the next cup, and get these different fractions, you end up extracting different materials at different rates. So bitterness comes out very quickly, sweetness slowly rises. And by the way, the sweetness apparently has nothing to do with sugar, because there is no sugar to speak of in roasted coffee. So it's an impression of sweetness that still needs to be nailed down. Why do we have that impression when there is, in fact, no sugar there? A lot of things take time to develop. Other things develop very quickly and then tail off. And so each of these fractions is going to have a different flavor. And of course, there's this tradition in brewing tea of doing something kind of like this, which is to say you pour some hot water onto tea leaves and taste that cup, and then more water and taste that cup, and you end up with a kind of time series of the development of the flavor of the tea. It's not just one thing. And so I think there's the possibility that this might be interesting in coffee, and I can imagine some someone like Dave, who is very good with machinery and stuff like that, developing a sampler so that you can mix 1, 5, and 7 and leave the rest behind and find your ideal, really dial in your favorite flavor. Anyway, as I say, this is really recent work, and there's a ton of it. They've published like a dozen different papers on different aspects of coffee flavor. So if you're interested in coffee flavor, most of the papers are available without a subscription needed at Jean Xavier's website at UC Davis. And then Bill Ristenpart has published this book, third edition. And by the way, at UC Davis, their course on the science of coffee is now the most popular course at the university. So anyway, that's what I've been taking a look at, and Dave has been doing something much more quantitative. So over to you, Dave.
Yeah, thanks, Harold. I've never actually had to do a presentation off of my own machine before, so I don't know how this is going to work, or if it's going to work. But I was supposed to write a second book many years ago, and I haven't written it yet, although I have worked on it quite a bit. But the book that I wrote that came out 10 years ago, the original On Food and Cooking was when? Was it?
1984.
84, yeah. So, not quite like that. But it's 10 years coming up, and so my editor was like, "Hey, let's do. How do I plug? Let's do a 10th anniversary." So I said, "Okay, but what you really don't want to do with your life is reread something you wrote 10 years ago." because what you have to do is say, well, do I really believe any of the stuff that, which one of these do I play to make it actually do a show? Oh God, Harold, can you help me out? You know how to do this stuff. View, show, it's not up on the thing?
No.
Oh. I use the green one like you told me.
Your menu bar is, but not the...
Do they have the wrong... they have the wrong monitor? You have my second monitor? Yeah. I need this one to appear and come on. It worked in the pregame show, people. They'll figure it out. I'm sure they'll figure it out. So, yeah, that is my computer, but it must be the... They're showing this monitor here. I'll have it capture. Fungal. Right, you're figuring it out. But I do need that other monitor to come back to life. So one of the things I really realized 10 years ago, so when you're writing a book, what happens is you have a limited amount of time. And your editor keeps on wanting you to hand the book in. And if you're anything like I am, you want to keep researching more and more and more because you don't want to be wrong. You hate being wrong. You hate saying things that are incorrect, even though you're bound to say things that are incorrect constantly. In fact, you hardly ever say anything that's correct. Oh, I must say this. I promised my wife that I would not get up here and say that I was doing a slipshod job the first time around and that everything I said before was wrong, because I don't think that's the case. But while I've had an opportunity to go over, I realized how much of the data, and my cocktail book is relatively data-driven. It's not...
You have three PowerPoints open. You have to close all of them, those that you don't need.
Okay. The one that says Harvard is the one to keep.
I don't know.
Okay, yeah. It was working before. This is irritating. So I think it's not showing my monitor because this is the one here. I have like three, like I knew this was going to be an issue. I have like 8,000 monitors. Is this a monitor? Now I can no longer see it. And okay, can you guys see where the make a go button is? Make happen?
Down.
Down. All right, now how do I make it into a slideshow? I'm old people and I also hate this and I can't see that far away. Which one of these? Okay.
I think it's F5.
F5, thank you. Someone with a keystroke. Oh! Yay! Keystrokes. All right. Super. All right, and then we'll get this back up in a minute. Oh no, really? Okay. So what happened is I wrote a book, a technical book about cocktails. The second and third sections of which are all about new techniques in cocktails, things that I did a lot of development work on, such as new uses of acids, new uses of things like liquid nitrogen, uses of rotary evaporators. Milk washing, like nitrous infusion, all sorts of stuff like this. Different techniques that, when everyone else was pushing food, there was a small group of us that were pushing new techniques in cocktails, and I was one of those people, so I got to write the book on it. When you write the book first, it's good. It's good to be the first person to write a book on a subject. It's helpful, in English anyway. I digress. But the point is that one of the things I did in the first section was not dealing with new techniques. Instead, it was analyzing the structure of cocktails in general. And the analysis of that structure of cocktails in general very much helps you get a handle on what you're doing, even if you're not using new techniques and technologies. So I did a lot of analysis of things like sugar and acid and alcohol and dilution and how those things interact to make the different, and temperature, to make the different, and carbon dioxide, to make the different styles of, and salt. Notice which one I left out? What? Bitter. You know why? Bitter is super complicated, right? Anyway, I'll get to that a little bit in a second. So, what I did was I had to make some assumptions because liquor companies, while they're contractually or legally obligated, rather, to give you the alcohol by volume, the ABV, they are not obliged to tell you how much sugar or acid is in their products. They're not. And in fact, they don't. Wine nerds do. So wine nerds will tell you exactly how much residual sugar is in wine and exactly how much, they don't use titratable acidity, which is what I use, they use total acidity. So it's easy to study those. So I would do things like, oh, vermouth is a wine, and therefore, I'm going to put the acid numbers for wine into my vermouth numbers, and that's how I'm going to run my calculations. Or it's very hard to measure acidity, or I thought it was. We're going to talk about that. So I'm going to read a bunch of papers and take an average of what people say the acidity of X, Y, or Z is. I was like, most liquors are in that 250 grams of sugar per liter kind of range, and so I'm just going to kind of average it out. So this time, because I'd already done a lot of the initial work, I was like, that's not really acceptable. So I said to myself, how am I going to measure these things and I spent months trying to figure it out because it's actually technically pretty difficult. But as you can see, I figured out easy ways to do all of this. So part of what I've been doing is analyzing hundreds and hundreds of samples of products to figure out how close I was the first time around. But also, you should know that, I wouldn't do it if you don't, it's not free, but, you can now buy, you guys know what a refractometer is, roughly? Yeah. So for those of you that don't, it actually, people say it measures, What it measures is really a change in like the refractive index of your medium, right? And then that way that light is bent is then correlated to a number. Usually I deal with sugar, so it deals with sugar. But things, alcohol bends light, salt bends light, acids bend light. And luckily, the sugars that we use, which we're going to get into in depth in a second, they all bend at about the same amount on a weight basis. So it's very lucky. So you get a little refractometer and you measure it, right? So you try to find out how much sugar. The problem is that in alcohol, alcohol bends and sugar bends. So if you don't know, right, if you don't know exactly what you're dealing with, it's not possible to use a refractometer to separate the alcohol data from the sugar data. So if you have only alcohol, you can, and water, you can use a refractometer. If you have only sugar and water, you can use a refractometer. But nothing in between. But look at this. Nowadays, so you guys know what a hydrometer is? So a hydrometer measures the density of something. So a lot of spirits people will use them, brewers will use them, many people use them. And the old school hydrometers are like a large glass tube with a weight at the bottom. And then you get what amounts to a graduated cylinder. And you have to get a bunch of liquid. You measure the temperature of the liquid. You drop the hydrometer and it bobs like a buoy. And it bobs at exactly, you read off the line where it's touching the liquid. And that's the density of your liquid, right? The problem with this technique is that it takes a lot of liquid, and you need to know the temperature of it. Real pain in the ass. So now, for $400, you can call the Anton Parr Corporation, or you can get it on Amazon. They'll send you a density meter that only requires 10 milliliters. I can actually do it with four. Four. I'm pretty good, though. I've done hundreds and hundreds of samples with it. So I can take 15 milliliters of alcohol now and get six consecutive identical Brix readings and two consecutive readings on this, which I consider, if those match good enough, I consider I've done a good job, right? And this data point plus this data point theoretically gives you the answer. The problem is that it's actually quite complicated because the density of everything changes differently. So the density of sugar solutions change differently with temperature than the density of alcohol solutions, right? And so there's just a crap ton of numbers that you have to do. But there's this lunatic who wrote a program called AlcoDens LQ that does it for you. So you just pay this man $300, or you use the copy that is, what's it called, a free trial, and it gives you 15. So if you have enough computers in your house, you can use it like 100 times before you have to pay the guy. Look, God bless the guy, because he's like, I don't give discounts. I don't give educational discounts, or I don't do it. I'm like, all right, man, right? And he was like, I was like, listen, I'll push your product. He's like, you're going to push your product, my product anyway. I'm like, crap. You know what I mean? But I do encourage you to get the free ride first. So what am I learning? I have a very internally, I'm scared all the time whenever I see the lids left off of alcoholic containers, because I do a lot of mixing of large alcoholic batches in big containers. And so it freaks me out because I'm like, I'm evaporating, I'm losing it. And then I always say to myself, you know, you're an idiot. It's not really evaporating that much. Someone left a cap off one of my bottles of liquor, and I don't know exactly how long, Galliano. And, you know, who knows how long that was there before I found out the cap was off. It's Galliano. How often do I use it, right? And, I mean, it's good, but how often do I use it? So it went from 42.3% alcohol when I measured it to, like, 20. So I'd evaporate, which also meant it turned into simple syrup. It was like 400 grams per liter. Anyway, so like by running these data, I've learned a lot of things. Like, for instance, there's not nearly as much acidity in vermouth as there is in wine because it's watered down with spirits. And the spirits don't have acid. I should have thought of that beforehand, but you know, you can only think so much when you're working. Or the fact that Campari and Aperol, you guys know Campari and Aperol roughly? So one's 24% alcohol, one's 11% alcohol. Which one do you think is sweeter? Oh, that's an interesting choice. Most people would say that it's Aperol. Answer is they're the same. But because Aperol has a stronger alcoholic base and because it's more bitter, right, people perceive the Aperol as sweeter because it's just has less bitterness involved in it. All right, so this is what I've been working on. And simultaneously, I've been working on things like sugar. So in my initial copy of the book, I tell people, and I still tell people, that at the bar, I don't have a bar right now, maybe again. I like to use one-to-one simple syrup, meaning that one part sugar, one part water by weight. And the reason I like that is it pours very easily. 2-to-1 is kind of a pain in the butt. It's harder to stir down properly. It can, I just don't like it as much, right? I like 1-to-1. And so I wrote all my recipes with that. I got into this, but then a lot of people like 2-to-1, and then they always lie. They don't lie. Bartenders always get wrong how to convert them, right? So one of the things I had to do for the book was explain how to actually convert between grams of sugar and regular simple syrup and rich simple syrup. Now then I had a problem. There's a bartender friend of mine, Shannon Mustafer, who's like kind of like a rum person. And we were having a daiquiri discussion, and I said to her, hey, listen, I make my daiquiris with simple syrup, and she's like, she doesn't talk like this, but let's just say she said I was a jerk. She uses white sugar. And a lot of the original kind of Cuban bartenders use white sugar and they dissolve it in. Now I'd be damned if I want to use raw sugar at a bar. These people are actually sitting there at a bar with spoons as if that's going to be accurate, like putting spoonfuls of sugar into lime juice and then stirring the sugar into the lime juice. This is like my worst, this is my worst nightmare, right? And so I did a little math, right? And here it is. Here's two daiquiri recipes. Now, first of all, Shan, I did a kind of a mix between three of my friends' daiquiri recipes, right? And of course, I did the math. So the two recipes are, right, 10 grams of sugar. This is a dry daiquiri, right? 10 grams of sugar dissolves to 6.3 milliliters. I've done the math. Don't argue with me. And then 16.3 milliliters of simple syrup is a little more than a half of an ounce. So this is a very dry daiquiri for 3/4 of an ounce of lime juice and 60 milliliters of rum. So I did this experiment in front of, I don't know, like 100 people at Tales of the Cocktail, which is a place, you know, it's an event in New Orleans. And we served to the guests these identical drinks. And I didn't actually have anyone shake it. I calculated the dilution that you would get from shaking it based on my curve fits from Excel, which I still believe in from the original edition of the book. Served them out to everyone pre-chilled and had little aerolatte foamers so that they could revitalize the cocktail like at their seats. And then I had them anonymously vote via their telephone on an app called Slido, because I figured there's not going to be that much difference because, look, it's only... Look how little of a difference there is between these two cocktails. How big of a difference could it possibly make, right? Well, it turns out, and so this shows you so the green line here is the sugar to acid ratio goes down slightly, and the dilution, as the initial ABV of your drink goes up, it does dilute more, but it never dilutes more enough to catch up to the fact that you started with more water. Ignore, but that's just whatever. It's what it is. So, what happened? Ooh, it wasn't close. And the people I talked to afterwards were like, it wasn't not close. And I was bent. So I was like, okay, look, this tiny amount of extra dilution, which I never would have guessed, actually very critically changes people's reaction to the cocktails. And I don't have time to talk about reactions in aggregate, but you should always gather reactions to things you make that people are going to consume in aggregate. Not your own opinion, not just your buddy's opinion, in aggregate. So this was like a sample of like, I don't know, 80-something people. So I'm very upset. And what I thought is, well, maybe, and this is why I was working on the sugar ruler so much, maybe I can just use rich simple syrup and get away with it. But I don't know, I didn't want to give up yet because it wasn't 100% blind. We asked the people whether they liked the sugar one or the simple syrup one in front of a Cuban bartender and a rum person who were telling them that they use sugar. So I was like, not fair. Not fair to me, right? So, and again, I will not sit there with a little freaking sugar bowl at bar time. So I went to England, to the Campari Academy, and did it again. Smaller group of people did the exact same experiment, exact same recipe, and 67%, exactly the same percentage of people preferred the sugar to the simple syrup. It makes it even worse. I didn't put this data up there, but I also included rich simple syrup, which is 2-to-1, which has a lot less water in it. And was like, well, maybe people are gonna like, maybe like in between is gonna be the answer. Nope. They wanted the sugar, and in fact, regular simple syrup beat, for some crazy reason, in the responses, and it's only a sample of like 25 or something, but regular simple syrup lost handily, as did rich simple. But then I did it again, and I asked a slightly different question. Now, any of you that are bartenders out there know that this is very dry, right? So a little bit over a half of an ounce of sugar is a very, very dry daiquiri, right? Standard would be much closer to 3/4 of an ounce of simple syrup, right? Like 12 and a half grams of sugar, not, and again, this seems like small numbers, right? So I did it with that. I did it with 12.3 grams of sugar, right, versus 20 milliliters, which is a short 3/4 of an ounce of regular simple syrup. And, oh yeah, I was like, boom, boom. I don't want that dry freaking daiquiri. Give me the one with 20 milliliters of freaking syrup that everyone likes better than the one with sugar. So happy. But it left me with, I mean, I was like, I can't tell you how upset I was. It was like, it's really, really bad news. For those of you that don't work in a bar scenario, the idea behind a wet, dark bar of using, trying to accurately dose granulated sugar is the worst. It's just the worst. Anyway, so, but I don't really understand why. So there's other weird things that I've noticed in my cooking life that show these kind of bimodal responses. So for instance, when you cook salmon, if you cook salmon, they don't really do this anymore because it's so polarizing, but people used to cook salmon at very, very low temperatures. And there would be this kind of rise of I like. I know it's not a very, you know, of like. There was a rise of like, and then it fell into a dip, and then it came up again. So I don't really know what's going on here, but I am just extraordinarily thankful. But in the meantime, by the way, while I was working on this, I was like, I really have to think of a dense syrup. So it caused me to develop this stuff, which I still need a name for. You see how this is relatively pourable, right? This is volumetrically twice as sweet as regular simple syrup. 2-to-1 simple syrup is not twice as sweet as simple syrup. This is 75 bricks, right? So the reason you can pour it is it's 37.5% sucrose, which is table sugar, 37.5% fructose, which is fructose, and only 25% water. And by the way, everyone says invert is so much, oh my God, I should have mentioned that first, but okay, we'll talk about it later. But anyway, so the point is that I need a decent name for this stuff, but yeah, this has very little water in it and can still be poured. And the reason that it's twice as sweet, even though it's only 75 bricks, is because fructose and sucrose together are synergistically sweet, especially in cocktails. It's actually one of the more complicated, fructose is incredibly complicated to think about. But I digress. So at the end of this talk I did at Daiquiri's, a bartender asked me a question. And she said, very famous bartender, she said, it's Monica Berg from the UK. She said, yeah, but you know, we were talking about inversion and sugar in general. And she said, yeah, but when you heat simple syrup, it inverts. So what does that mean? Sucrose is a disaccharide, right? It's made up of one glucose molecule and one fructose molecule joined together, right? And when you break those apart, it breaks into a glucose and a fructose, and that is what honey is. It's called invert syrup. We'll get to in a while. It has some interesting properties. So she said, I like to heat simple syrup as opposed to just blending it. Because I was like, I blend simple syrup because who wants to heat syrups? Right? Not only who wants to heat syrups, but why do you want to have to worry about heating it and then reweighing it to make sure you haven't boiled off water? Who wants to do this? Why would you want to make a syrup and then be able to use it in an hour and a half when it cools off, when you could just put it in a blender and use it in 30 seconds from now? Right? Anyway, so she said, no, it pours better when you heat it because the sugar inverts. And I said, I don't think so. But I had no way to prove it. Right? So let's talk a little bit about inversion. So why is it called invert? This is like, it's kind of a fascinating subject. Let's get this, let's get the what's it called up here? The whatever this is. monitor. And then how do I? Oh yeah, there we go. We're gonna do it over here. It's gonna happen. It's gonna exist. Is someone coming with the camera? Is it gonna work? All right, it will. I have good faith. So what is it? What's going on? So sugar is what's called many things, but sugar, sucrose, and fructose and glucose are what's called chiral molecules. And what that means is that they exist in forms that are mirror images of each other. And because of that, right, if you take something like a screw that has a right-handed screw and a left-handed screw, right, if you take a screw and you turn it around, it's still the screw is facing the same way, right? So these molecules, many of these chiral molecules, interact with light in a very interesting way. If you have polarized light, right, so in other words, like all of the kind of all of the waves are kind of lined up in the same direction, linearly polarized light. Are we going to get a camera over here for the? If you end up with linearly polarized light, and then you pass it through a sample that is it has this optical property, right? It will turn the light. So here's a polarizer. I'll go around you. So here's a polarizer. Oh, fun fact. All of your computer, all of your computer monitors are polarized, right? They go going through a polarizer. So you've already started with one polarizer, and then you can get like a second polarizer, and then let's see.
Is it? You want to go directly above?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, here, step up on the, here. This is what we're doing in the there you go. Yeah. All right. Okay. So, you can see if you put this in front, if you could.
Oh, that's great.
If you, can we kill these lights a little bit? That's what we did before.
Take the camera. I'll hit events.
Sorry about this. We did practice. All right. So look at here. Once that overhead's cut off, right? So here's the screen, and you put the polarizer over it, and it's dark. And you turn the polarizer, and you can see the stuff that's going underneath. So let's take a look at sucrose. Okay, sucrose. Here, this is a 50 bricks, my favorite, regular simple syrup, right? So here it looks like what it is. And you put this over it, and now you see that when the screen is blocked, you can still see through the sucrose. And if you rotate this, right, in the proper direction, you can see kind of exactly how much the light is bent by the sucrose. Now, when you see this here, which you can see, right, you see how this tube is full? It's very important that you get this path length, because it's one of the concentration and also how long a path the light has to go through changes how much it bends. So this is the same exact solution, but it's only half the length. And so you'll see, right, that this one goes dark first because it doesn't rotate the light as much. And then the full one, I have to rotate it more because the light going through more solution, right, gets to rotate longer. Concentration is also important. So if I take it and I dilute it, so this has half the dilution of the original, right? You'll see that the one that has half the path length and the one that has half the dilution, well, they turn off at about the same time. And then the other one, you still have to rotate all the way through to get it to turn off. Another interesting fact, or at least I find it interesting, I don't know where my mouse went. I think it's on the floor somewhere, and I'm very bad with dark lights. There we go. You can see it. All right. I'm gonna do so much more of this. Hold on a second.
We're just trading off.
Oh, trade. All right. Yeah. We're good. I think we're good. All right. So check this out. The amount that the light is bent is also dependent on the wavelength. So if you can see here. Are we, can you, yeah, get in, see how this is off? And then when I move it onto the red, it's not off anymore. because the amount that it's bent is very wavelength dependent. That's why when I built this little, which you can build for almost nothing if you already have a multimeter in your house, I built this little polarimeter, which very accurately measures, I can do it within about half a degree, but I use a red LED because red LEDs, even though they don't bend as much, right, are much a much more of a single spectral line, right? So, boom, I love that. All right, so how is this helping? What do you like better, red or blue?
Red.
All right, red it is. So let's see what happens when we ran a test. Oh, first of all, this is sucrose, right? This is dextrose, right? So dextrose is, by the way, it's called dextrose because it rotates light to the right? And this is one of the components of sucrose. And then here is fructose, which is also known as levulose because it rotates light to the left. And let's take a look. All right, so they're all passing light. Now, if I turn this like this, first thing that's gonna turn dark should be the dextrose, which is in the middle, right? And it does, right? Then the sucrose is gonna turn dark. But why is that fructose not turning? Oh, look, it's because I have to go in the other direction to turn the fructose off, right? And so what happens is that fructose has such a turn in the other direction as opposed to the dextrose, right, that it actually switches the whole plane of light. So sugar inversion is literally when the light gets inverted from here all the way over to this side. And I can demonstrate that. Oh, and by the way, my friend asked about inversion, it doesn't happen. I pressure cooked simple syrup for 45 minutes and measured it with my polarimeter, and you know how much inversion there was, roughly? Zero is the correct answer. No, you need acid. And so a lot of people who are doing sugar inversion tricks, let's see, so this is cooked with acid at 60 minutes. This is cooked at acid for 10 minutes. This is cooked for 30 minutes. Let's scale it like that. And this is not cooked at all. So if you look at this, you can actually see the process. I'll do it this way. You can see the process of inversion. So the first thing that's going to go black is the straight sucrose, right? And then as I go in, you'll see over time that the one that's been cooked for 10 minutes is going to go, can you get like as far as you can get straight? I know it's hard, but because you're seeing through the side of the tube, which is unfair to the test. Should I move closer to you? Yeah. All right, so sucrose goes black first. Then as we go through, right, you can see that the one that was cooked here is starting to go, but wait a minute, we've already hit zero, it's inverted, right? So it's going dark after the inversion point, and the last one, which is fully inverted, goes, can you see it? Last. Can you get straight down the barrel of that guy? Is it possible? There. So that's that, here, this one here. Yeah, so that's last, and then you can see it invert through the inversion point, and then those go. And this is just cooking from syrup. So another interesting fact about this that you know I don't have time to show you, but acids are also chiral. I think you're. Thank you so much. I think that's good. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Acids are also chiral, and so if you look at I need to get back to where I once belonged. Oh, let's see. If you, no, I need to get back to the PowerPoint. If you, my PowerPoint's still on the other screen?
It's on the other screen.
Oh, God. Pia, can you make this happen? I would appreciate it so much if you could. If you can't, I totally understand it. So it turns out that the amount of acid you add is obviously, depends on how quickly it inverts. So we tested here at Harvard today. Alejandro and Kuro and I in the lab sat around inverting stirrers for you guys today and very accurately measuring them. And the inversion happens much more rapidly with more acid, on the order of 1% by sugar weight, right? But that's a lot of acid. So 0.25% of sugar weight gets it almost fully inverted with a 30 to 60 minute cook, right? But here's the cool thing. See these things here? So this is pressure cooked simple syrup with nothing, 1:1. Pressure cooked for 45 minutes, 15 PSI, about 259 degrees Fahrenheit. No inversion at all, and also no color. This is the 0.25% acid per unit sugar, tartaric acid. Notice how it's straw colored, right? And this one is with the 1%. So what's happening is it's breaking it down to the extent at those temperatures, fructose is actually decomposing. So what happens when you look at these, if we can get the numbers back, is that it goes from being fully inverted to start swinging back as the fructose breaks down. So what I'm gonna do now is do caramels and try to figure out how I can measure how much sugar is actively left to see whether some of the molecule, breakdown molecules, if I can figure out like how non-chiral they are, I can do analysis of caramels and try to figure out how much they've broken down. But the fructose generally breaks down first. All right, last things last. I'm gonna pass this around. So another thing I wrote in the book is that succinic acid, and I'll start with you, even though you know you know this. In fact, when we first started hanging out in the early 2000s, I did this demo at a Taste Mondavi, right? So this is succinic acid. Only eat a little bit of it, because it's terrible tasting. But when I was first researching lime juice, I just looked up, as I told you, the numbers, and it came out that lime juice has a little bit of this stuff called succinic acid in it. And I ran some tests to figure out, does it really make a difference? And so I would make what's called fake lime acid, which is 2:1%. Lime and lemons are about 6% acidity, about. And I was doing tests where I was making up fake lime acid and then doing it with and without succinic. And it was one of my early introductions to the fact that something that tastes bad on its own really makes something taste better. And I don't know if you remember, but it's way better with the succinic acid. But it was very hard to get and very expensive. So I didn't use it at my bar, and I mentioned it in my book, but didn't think about it, and didn't even use it for my own work, even though I had it. How stupid is this? Because when you're a teacher, sometimes, especially when I was working at the French Culinary Institute, I was all about what it's possible for the people I'm teaching to use, not just what I can do because I can do it. So then I meet this guy at an event, and he's like, hey, thanks for including that crap about succinic acid. It really makes my RTD cocktails pop. And I'm like, why haven't I been using, so when I first wrote that stuff when I first worked on that in 2004, I wasn't acid adjusting yet. So now what I do is I take low acid fruits and I add acidity to them so that I can use them as non-diluted mixers in cocktails, things like pineapple, whatever. So I measure the acidity and then I add it. And it turns out that when you're adjusting to lime, just a little bit of succinic acid, so the equivalent of like 3 drops out of that dropper in a drink that's passing around, is enough to make this stuff really pop and go crazy. So I convinced Modernist Pantry they're up the street. Nasty, right? Nasty. Your mouth now tastes like blood and oysters. And you're welcome. But it is very key. And so if you have a little bit of it, and so the way to use it is to make an 8% solution. You make an 8% solution because that's about the maximum you can dissolve. It's very hard to weigh minute quantities of acids at a bar. So I make a solution and then I use it. So that's what I've been doing. So last but not least, here's the test that we're running because we're almost out of time, right? We're good? Yeah. Oh, all right, but then we can get questions and crap. Oh, great. So here's where we see kind of what kind of a fool I am. So I was trying to not guess anymore. I was trying to measure everything, right? So one of the hardest things to measure is acidity. I thought it was the hard thing to measure. So I learned, because in high school, I hated doing titrations. Do you know what titrations are? Yeah, so for those of you that don't, you take a known quantity of your analyte, whatever you're trying to analyze, right? And then you take, let's say we're starting with an acid, because we are, you take a known quantity of a known concentration of base. It's good to use a strong base, so I use sodium hydroxide, lye. And by the way, it sucks working with lye. Listen to me. Don't try to do first of all, don't try to store. Okay, so soap makers talk about storing their, what's called, backup. Lye is very hygroscopic. So lye will suck water out of the, what is this? Is that my button? Lye will suck water out of the air. So if you actually care about the concentration that you're making with lye, it is very, very difficult. And you cannot save the lye by putting the desiccant packet in because it is more hygroscopic than the desiccant packet is. And so it's very, very difficult. In fact, when I first started doing it with the lye that I had to standardize my lye solution by titrating it back to a known quantity of acid. And by the way, the acids that you use are also garbage. Like, they don't tell you whether they're monohydrates or not. Remember I told you about racemic acids? It turns out that the malic acid that you buy is not biologically made. It's synthesized, which means it's racemic, which means it's a mixture of both the left-turning and the right-turning molecules. And what that means for you is it's a little tartar than it would be. So in fact, if you're using... So I say that all these acids taste the same, but really racemic malic acid tastes the same kind of acid as citric acid, but the stuff in actual limes doesn't. Does that make sense? But we don't buy that, and I didn't have any idea whether I... How do I know? Until I built the polarimeter and tested it. I was like, oh, snap, here's another one for you. I told people to use... First of all, I made this assumption, incorrect, by the way. You ever make two mistakes and they add up to a win? here's one of those mistakes that added to a win. So lactic acid used to be sold primarily as a solution, something like 88% lactic acid. Lactic acid is the acid in pickles and sauerkraut. That's a pickle, so. But salami also. Anyway. It also is the characteristic acid of things that go through malolactic fermentation. So a lot of champagnes, they have tartaric and malic acid. So something like Krug that hasn't gone through malolactic fermentation, you'll get that green apple note from the malic acid. But if it has it, they say it goes kind of softer because it actually reduces the quantity of acid in there. Again, I digress. So, lactic acid, first of all, I assumed it had this similar, because I don't eat it on its own, I assumed that lactic acid had a similar tartness on your mouth as the other acids, and that so did tartaric. It doesn't. Tartaric is actually much tartar than the other acids, and lactic acid is much weaker than the other acids. And furthermore, I hate having to deal with liquids. Okay, remember how I said I hate having to deal with powder, with powders at the bar? Yes, but during weighing time, when I'm making syrups and acids, I like the powders because I feel that they're more stable. So I suggested to everyone to buy lactic acid powder. You know what lactic acid powder isn't? Pure, correct. And so you're like, well, how impure can it be? They don't even list what they jack it. They jack it with calcium lactate, which is why it actually throws off a lot of crystals when you use high percentages of it, which I'd seen for years and just kind of ignored. I was like, I don't know, who cares? I titrated it. 55% pure, the sample that I had, 55%. So for years, I've been making this one-to-one mixture of tartaric acid and lactic acid powder, and it works in similar acid levels as 6% lemon and lime juice, but it's nowhere near 6% acidity, and nothing is actually what I thought it was, and yet this recipe has been working for 12 years. You know? So, like, anyway. Hard to measure acidity. I luckily online found so if you're doing only clear things like lemon juice, I think it's very fun to do, don't do volumetric, it sucks. Do weight-based titration. So you take that bottle with the succinic acid I'm passing around, you fill it with base, and you just weigh it beforehand, and each one of the drops out of that bottle, if you use an analyte, if you have a milligram-based scale that can do three digits, and you use at least 10 grams of analyte, you can get like 0.03 or 0.02 resolution on your titratable on percent. So I'm talking like 1.003. That can be your resolution and your accuracy with that dropper without having to use burettes, without having to figure out any of the temperature, just boop, and measuring. It's actually really easy, except for the fact that phenolphthalein is very hard to see that transition in red wine or in Pasubio or in anything that has acid. So I found on Amazon someone was selling a $400 pH meter for $86 by mistake. Prime, next day, buy. As soon as I bought it, they took it off the market. I was like, finally, a win. And so that's what I was using to do it. But then I was thinking, it's kind of similar to what Harold was saying about baking soda. I was like, wait a minute. Baking soda releases exactly one molecule of CO2 for every acid molecule, every proton that it neutralizes. Now here's where the universe is helpful. So I was really nervous, and I was talking to a friend of mine at University of Rochester about using infrared spectroscopy to try to shoot a bunch all of these samples and use machine learning to try to backpedal out all of the products that were in it. So I was going to make challenge samples with different levels of alcohol, different levels of all the sugars and acids that I wanted, and get all the information back. And we went well down the way. I was mainly worried about the acids until I realized that even though all the acids have different molecular weights, right, they have different numbers of protons that they can give up. So citric acid is triprotic, can give up 3 protons. Malic acid and tartaric acid, I believe, 2. Lactic acid, 1. Here's what's nuts. And they all have, like I say, different molecular weights. But when you actually do the math, they're all within 10% of each other. So as long as you know of each other, right? So if you say that something was 1, if you say something is 1% acidity, the other one's going to be like 1.1 or 1.2, which bar-wise is identical. It's not like even close. It is identical. It's like when you're doing the pendulum math. You know, when you're doing the pendulum math and you're like sine of theta equals theta. You know what I'm saying? As long as we're near zero and you draw those little wavy equal signs and everyone's happy, that's how close it was. And so I was like, whoa, I can just titrate this. And as long as I really kind of know what the base acid is, it's going to work out. And then I was like, okay, if I know that exactly one proton is going to be neutralized by each molecule, I'm going to lose one CO2 molecule, I know the weight of a CO2 molecule, and I know the weight of the base acids, right? So all you got to do is get a scale, if you can get one when it does 3 digits, that's better. This one does 2 digits, and it does 200 grams. You want to get at least 100 mils of the analyte. So what you do is you very, very accurately, now by the way, this could fail miserably, because what I did is I had Kuro make a solution, and I was like, don't tell me what the acidity is, right? So this is like when I reveal whether I got it right. And we did it earlier today, and I got the right answer. And I've done it at home. Of course, I use my fancy, fancy scale. But I want to see if you could do it with like a $10 scale. So what you do, you add the you put the analyte in here. You very accurately weigh the analyte. Then you put excess, important that it be excess baking soda in here, right? Then you make sure that everything can be covered because you don't want to evaporate while you're working. You want to also, like, you know, kind of burp it because it's going to be making CO2. You want it to be able to flash off but not evaporate. That's the goal. You then, before you do the reaction, weigh everything. So you weigh your core container with its lid. You weigh the baking soda container with its lid, with the stir rod in the analyte. You weigh the whole thing, all right? So I did that. The initial weight, where's the last slide? Oh, is it still? Let's get the last slide up here, and then you guys can hold me honest to my math. All right, so the original amount of analyte in here was 117.30 grams. All right, 117.30, enter. Normally I convert it to volume, but that's too much. Can we just do it by weight? Can we just stipulate? Okay. Because I have a density meter, it's really trivial for me to convert between weight and volume, but, you know, I'm fancy. The entire rig with everything in it weighed 209.07 grams. This is tartaric acid, I know because I handed him the acid to test with. Let's turn on. Come on, get out. Man, I hope this works. Kuro, I hope this freaking works, man. All right, so right now we are at 207.95. You know that you can't agitate a table, right? Anyway, all right, so let's do the math. 209 minus, I'm sorry, I'm in reverse polar, so I have to say it the way I do it. 207.95 minus, oh, I wrote the wrong number, son of a bitch. Can someone do the math faster? Someone who knows how to type better. Okay, 207.93 minus, we lost 1.14 grams of CO2, which you multiply that for tartaric by 170.5 times, and we're going to divide it by the weight of the, I messed up. All right. You can see my calculator is a pain. It's helpful for large calculations. No one's going to help me and do this for me, huh? 07, enter. All right. Someone write this down so if I lose it again, I don't have to It's hard to talk and type. What did I say, 1.14 or 1.12 before? 1.12, right? 1.12 grams of carbon dioxide is what we lost? Someone? Anyone? Yeah, that's right. 1.12 grams of carbon dioxide, we're going to multiply by 170.5. That is 190.96. We are going to take the weight of analyte, which was 117.30, and we are going to divide 1.6.
1.59.
Woo! I got 1.62, so I'm within a tenth of a percent, better than tenth of a percent. So you can do this, especially if you're not talking to people while you're doing the math. You could literally just test the acidity of something in your house with a scale that you probably already own, and you don't have to, you know, wait for a $400 pH meter to come on sale for. You should wait about that length of time that I waited, though, and stir it during it. But anyway, excess. Remember, weigh everything excess baking soda. Anyway.
Pretty impressive. Pretty good place to end. Okay, awesome. Let's give our speakers a hand. Thank you so much. Super impressive.